Good morning. Please join me in the call to worship printed in your bulletin. If you are delighted to be here, and if you are tired and troubled, you are welcome. If your faith is strong, and if your faith is battered and frail, you are welcome. If you are eager to praise God, and if you need to be quiet, you are welcome. God welcomes us all to worship today and promises to meet us here. Our opening hymn is number one in the hymnal, Summoned by the God Who Made Us. And please stand if you are able. So welcome to this service of worship. Throughout this summer, LAMC Worship has been focused on practicing our faith, We've been exploring a variety of everyday practices that can strengthen our connection with God, ourselves, others, and creation. Today, we focus on radical hospitality, and Shauna Siobhan Green will be bringing the message. So we will now sing God Who's Giving, which is number 745 in our hymnal. It's our offering hymn. I see. Okay. We are grateful for all of the gifts that all of you offer to the church, your time, all of the acts of service, and the monetary gifts as well. Please join me in prayer. God of cosmos and quarks, God of rainbows and roly-polies, God of electricity and enzymes, you created the earth and proclaimed it good. The galaxies and planets are known to you, yet also the hairs on our heads. You cradle all things in the palm of your hand, supporting us with love. We magnify your name for our creation and for all the blessings of this life. Sustain in us a spirit of awe for how you continue to be present in the world, providing in so many ways, and help us to act with love and generosity toward all that you have created. Amen. Let us sing together the hymn number 56, in the purple hymnal, like the murmur of the dove's song. Our scripture today is in the book of Matthew, chapter 25, and we'll be starting at verse 31 and reading through verse 40. And you can find it on page 807 in your pew Bible if you wish to read along. When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep at his right hand and the goats at the left. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, "Come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me." Then the righteous will answer him, "Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you?" And the king will answer them, "Truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these who are members of my family, you did it to me." Our sermon today is from Reverend Shauna Siobhan Green. We look forward to your message, Shauna.
They messed up and gave me a mic where I can move around. I'm glad you prayed to the God of electricity. My iPad is at 23%. So you might get 1/4 of a message today, and then we're just gonna freestyle the rest. But I did bring the paper copy just in case. So if I start ad-libbing, I'm just looking for my spot. You know, I always like to start with who I am, and some of your faces are very familiar, while others I may not know yet. I am a distant descendant of Hagar. I am the great-great-granddaughter of Thelma. I am the granddaughter of Edna, and I am the daughter of Arlene, all who have transitioned to become the mighty cloud of witnesses that watch over me today. I feel like Timothy with his grandma Eunice, which is one of my favorite parts because I love a good grandma. So today, and Don didn't know this, but I'm remixing a little bit. You can yell at me after, but yell soft because I'm sensitive. We were talking about hospitality, but I changed it up a little bit, and we're going to do the power of welcoming, creating a sanctuary of belonging, because I think you got hospitality down, or we think we do. We'll see after this message. And just to, last time we laughed a lot, and we're going to laugh today because I don't have no good sense and I say things, but it's kind of going to have an ebb and a flow. We may start up, it may get a little deep, and then we'll rise again. I can guarantee you that. Last time I got the chance to speak with you, we ended honoring the body, and I really hope y'all remember that. I didn't see a lot of people taking notes, but whatever. We talked a bit about Mephibosheth. He was the hidden son of Saul that when David was looking for someone in Saul's lineage to bless, he was like, there ain't nobody. And his servant said, nuh-uh, there's a disabled or a person not in an enabled body that is the son of Saul that has been hidden away. David found him, invited him to the table, and Mephibosheth was the homie from that point on. Today, that story rang in my heart again, and I asked God why, because it's so hard to say that name over and over again without making a mistake. Like, aren't there stories about Janes and Toms and Esaus that are a lot easier for me to focus on that doesn't have 13 syllables? But that was not the case. So as I thought about it, the question that I pondered was, what was that table like? Like, I bet they had them big old chicken legs, like at the Renaissance Fest. Because that just feels like something that Jesus would have liked back then and like everybody would have enjoyed. I wondered if there were people holding grapes, because I mean, David was the king, and I really want someone to hold some grapes for me and fan and all of that. So I wonder, what was this table like? But then I remembered the table that we sit at today. I remembered the realistic tables that we've sat at. And as I go over them, I will choose to say, we don't set those tables here, but these are society's tables. That way y'all not at my car when I leave here. This last couple years, we've sat at tables of pain, of families that grieve their black and brown babies, to state-sanctioned violence, as I'm sure Mary grieved her son Jesus. We have sat at the table and witnessed the unprotected, the underserved, and the greatest shame of this nation as it continues to play out. Instead of middle passages and chains, it's guns, badges, and the lives of people that look like me, taken without just cause. We sat at the table of countless school shootings and mourned with those who have suffered deep loss as the world waits for, well, I don't know what we're waiting for. We've sat at the table and watched a pandemic ravage our communities, leaving lament and mourn in its wake, while people argue over whether or not we should wear masks. So the question I asked myself in all of this, as I prepared for today, is where is God? And what does God require of me? Anytime I ask the question, what does God require of me, I get really happy because I can go to Micah, and I can say Micah over and over again, not mess it up. Micah 6 and 8, God has shown you, O mortal, that's y'all, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? To act justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with your God. The more complicated answer is why I struggled to send the text this week. I'm sorry, Don. I know it got to be in 10 days prior, but the ADD in me don't move like that. So just know it might be 3 days prior, but it's going to be good. I know you guys are used to a lighthearted thing, but setting a table of inclusivity is heavy work. It causes us to look at ourselves. It causes us to investigate ourselves. It causes us to question ourselves. And it causes, I can move around. And it causes us to question our friendships. So when we talk about radical inclusivity, the question becomes, look to your left and look to your right. How many black people are in here? It's a quick count. It's two of us. I'm black. I know. You didn't know. I should have started with that. How many queer people are in here? That's the L, the G, the B, the T, the Q, the 2, the I, the A, and the plus. All right. And I wore every rainbow I could find today, and my earrings and my shirt and my shoes and my bracelet. I said, they will not miss me. Not today. I was going to wear a jacket, but my wife said, girl, you know you be hot. I said, you right. That's why the Lord sent me you. That's right. So I questioned myself back and forth, and I was like, oh, Lord, it's going to be heavy. It's pride. It's my month. I only get Black History Month in this one. I should be able to be excited and only talk about rainbow good things. But when it comes to me feeling one way and God feeling another, we all know who wins. I know you think it's me, but it's not. Today's message is about radical inclusivity. What does that mean? Y'all have sat here through a message with me before, so you know I like to tell you what it don't mean first. Radical inclusivity is not rainbows and welcoming statements, even though I love those things. They're important. It's not imagining or just hoping. And I love to imagine because we can't expect to see a world that's different if we can't even in our own minds begin to see what that world looks like. Radical inclusivity is not just the words we use for extreme. Like, I know on the news we hear about radical acts. That word simply means the root of a thing. It is rooted in whatever comes next. Radical inclusivity is about getting to the root of equity and accessibility. It is about getting to the heart of belonging and the practice of welcoming. It is about setting a table that is trusted and intentional. It means having gluten-free options, vegan options, kosher options. It's about inviting folks over for Shabbat. It's about being interfaith, intergenerational. It's about anti-racism. It's about gender diversity. It's about abhorring and fighting transphobia, homophobia. It's about going up to Topeka and campaigning and advocating for those that may not look like you, those that may not live like you, and those that may not love like you. It is about catering to those that you don't know. It's easy to be nice to the person that you love. Auntie Michelle can ask me for anything and I give it to her because it's easy because I love her. The person at the Quick Trip can ask me for $3 and I got questions. We ask ourselves, well, what would they use it for? Well, what does that have to do with you? Well, they're just going to get drugs. So is your relative that's addicted. They don't really need gas. They're not on a trip and their car just happened to break down. Well, what happened when it was you? Radical inclusivity is about giving even when you don't know what's going to happen to it, not enabling. I'm not asking you to enable the addicted. I am asking and inviting you to really take up the cross of loving your brother, loving your sister. And that means that they may come from a different mama. Lord knows they may come from a different mama. Radical inclusivity is a practice of Christ, as we saw in the text in Matthew. The part we read were for the sheep on the right side. It's funny because Nigerians have a quip where they call people foolish goats. This text made me feel like I never want to be called a goat because those were the things on the left. I will never look at a poor goat the same. But Jesus was pretty plain. I only let you read to verse 40 because I didn't want them at your car at the end. So I let you just read the nice part and I'm going to take the other part. I know, right? I'm so nice. So what happened to those to the left? What happened to those who were wondering? It's like when you watch America Idol. I know y'all don't watch TV. Y'all be praying all the time. But it's like praying and discerning. But it's like when you watch America Idol and they call some of the people to stand over here and some of the people to stand over there. And then they wait a long time. And then they're like, okay, this group, you're going home. And it is just the most shameful, anxiety-riding thing because I'm like, man, they really thought they made it, but they didn't. Imagine being the goat that goes to the left. Jesus was plain in verse 45. After he did the whole, when I was hungry, you fed me. When I was thirsty, you clothed me. No, that's not what happens. When I was thirsty, you gave me drink. When I was naked, you clothed me. When I was in prison, you visited me. After he said all of that, and they said the same thing. Oh, Jesus, when did we see you? When were you in jail? When did we call you? When did we check on your mom and them? When did we do those things? And Jesus said, ha, you didn't. He didn't say it like that, but I'm paraphrasing. What he actually said is, truly I tell you, whatever you did not do for one of the least of these, you did not do it for me. I think our hospitality is waiting for Jesus themselves and all of their blackness and cocoa butterness, because Mary never let Jesus go out ashy. I think we're waiting for Jesus with locks and full lips and a full nose and Jordan's own to actually come knock on our door. You might be waiting for a long time, and I know we do not know when that time will come, but Lord, let it not be today, because I have brunch after this. We're waiting for this image of Jesus that we recognize, and in some churches, the one that we don't, because some only honor the white one. We're waiting on a Jesus that looks like us, that talks like us, that lives where we live, that eats what we eat. And I'm here to tell you that Jesus may never come. In the meantime, there are people that are the examples of Christ around you every day. There are people that embody Christ around you every day. The Greek Bible talks a lot about the have and the have-nots and the ways of the people of the day. Some had a lot, some had none. When they talked about communion, Jesus said, don't eat all that you can. Only eat a little bit. Don't get full. This is not the Bob's Big Boy or what was it, at Golden Corral. You don't get two communion crackers and you can't have a cup of juice. It's one in one. Some had a whole lot. Some had little. But Jesus preached about what we now call and don't like to talk about, wealth redistribution. It's this idea that if you that have a lot, give a little, and you that have none, get a little, then we all can have some. This idea of some is shaky to many because we're full of greed, and the bigger the better in America. You got to have 12 rows of seats, only though you know two people, but I mean, whatever. Wealth redistribution and giving of what you have is radical inclusivity. It's beyond hospitality. It's beyond, will you open yourself up? It's beyond, if they come, then they can eat at my table. But what if they don't know to come? If they show up, then they can go downstairs for coffee and that really ice cold water. I don't know how that ice make that water so cold. Y'all have some of the best water ever. But how do they know to get it if nobody is there to invite them? As I look out at you, I want you to ask yourself, if you look through the last 20 pictures in your phone's camera, what do those people look like? If you look at your mantle at home or your gallery wall, I know y'all be watching HGTV and putting all them pictures on the steps. I think that's so cute. If you're white, are they all white? If you are Hispanic, Latino, Latinx, are they all that? If you're black, are they all black? What does that look like? And then ask yourself why. Don't be mad that I asked. Be concerned at what you find. Don't worry. I'm not asking you. Like, this isn't about Sapphira and Ananias. I ain't going to check and see if you gave all your belongings to the church. I'm going to let Dawn do that when she do the work of the church. She'll be the one to tell you to bring all your belongings. All I'm asking is and suggesting is if you have more, you can give more. If you have a full sheet of paper, I have one here because remember my iPad at 22%. If you have a full sheet of paper and someone else only has the margin, you got paper to spare. That is radical. That is inclusivity. It's not about making sure every visitor gets a goodie bag of Skittles and a pencil and a button that says, "We love to have you. Please come back and fill out this form." That visitor don't care about that form. They didn't come in here to fill out your forms. And I appreciate the pencils, and don't be mad at me. It's about Jesus. So take it up with them. It's about making sure every visitor gets greeted. I've been here, and I've seen where people will talk to one another, and the visitor walks by, which was me, and nobody said a word. I've been asked why I've chosen here. I've been asked and told, "Oh my gosh, now we have so much diversity, because my one black self has shown up." Now, I bring a lot of things, and I'm full of razzle-dazzle, but honey, one me is not what diversity makes. I think in Wichita, we're 13%, so you need at least 13 of me. Well, maybe not of me, because you won't be able to handle that, but you need 13 that is a shade of me before we even begin to touch the demographic of the city. Inclusivity is about making sure a person knows where the bathroom is. For my first 3 weeks here, I wanted to go to Sunday school, but I didn't know where the fellowship hall was. And I didn't feel that anyone had spoke to me enough outside of Don and Christina, who was already down there, so I couldn't ask them because they was already doing what they were supposed to do. That's on y'all. And it's not an indictment. I'm not here to convict you. I'm not here to blame you, but if we really want the church to grow, and we do, and if church is really not about these walls, which the pandemic showed us, which it is not, if we want to go from institution to inclusive, this is the truth that you need to hear, and you needed to hear it from somebody that looked like me. Ooh, somebody said amen. Hold on. Whoever it was, you don't got to raise your hand, but thank you. I'll give you a hug after church. That's the first out loud amen I done got at a Mennonite church. I feel like I done did it now. We can stop right there and go home. No, okay. See, now y'all think that everybody gonna be saying amen too late. Radical inclusivity is not about just asking someone how they are. It's about when they say fine, you know it's a lie. It's not about saying, "Oh, how you doing?" and then moving on to the next thing. It's about going deeper because we've all been conditioned in church to say we're fine. Because joy comes in the morning, and we don't talk about the weeping that we've done at night. Sometimes it's not about just saying, "What do you need?" It's about showing up with what you think they ought have. If I lose my job, it's not about asking me, "Do I need groceries?" You know I need groceries. Send me the Instacart and give me name brand stuff too, because I like Pepperidge Farm bread. If someone in my family passes away, don't ask me what I need. Send me a casserole, and not the one you make for your family every Tuesday. Send me the good one, like send me a lasagna. Because some people don't even know how to ask for help. Jesus is not using the parable and the term least of these to create a social hierarchy or make those on the margins feel less. I am marginalized in many identities, and I feel like I am the bag of chips. So I'm Jesus' favorite, and when you get there, you can talk to him about it. Jesus did not go to the cross so that we could look around and just see ourselves and see what we want. He is saying in that passage that when we fail to see the needs and pains of those that are devalued, those are being unjustly and unfairly persecuted, prosecuted, executed, those being disregarded, discarded, and dehumanized, that in not acting, we are complicit and we do not see him. The person beside you is not just the person who asks if you want to come to the quilt tying, which I do, but y'all be doing it during working hours and I be having to go to work. They are Jesus's beloved. The person beside you is not just the person who asked, "Could you sub for them at Sunday school next week?" and you rolled your eyes. They are the apple of God's eye. And when we see each other that way, think of how we would treat people different. Think of how we would respond. That is all God is asking of us, to check our privilege, to check our attitudes, and to check for when we are entertaining angels unaware. To see others not only as God sees us, but to see us as a mother sees their child, especially on those good days, because some days, whoo, or to see us as a shepherd sees their sheep. Radical inclusivity extends beyond our material possessions. It involves genuine engagement, active listening, and offering support in real and tangible ways to others. It means recognizing the needs of others and responding with love and compassion. And I don't know what your dictionary says, but love is a verb. Love requires action. Love gives. Love does. I invite us all today to radical transformation. Transformation in the way we view and interact with each other. Transformation in how we interact with those outside of these lovely stained glass walls. To move beyond the surface level inclusivity, the hashtags, and to address the systemic and systematic inequality and embody Christ's love for us all. When we do that, we can't help but be inclusive. We can't help but be a sanctuary of belonging. And we cannot help be an example of Christ. And that is the most radical person I know. May the Lord have a blessing to the reading of the word.
Our hymn of response is number 809, Sing a New World into Being, and please stand if you are able.
Thank you.
I send you with this. You, the one from whom on different paths all of us have come, to whom on different paths all of us are going. Make strong in our hearts what unites us. Build bridges across what divides us. United, make us rejoice in our diversity, and at one in our witness to your peace, a rainbow to your glory. Amen.